am the ground station manager and mission operations lead here at the FASOF. The FASOF, or in other words, the FA Aachen Space Operations Facility, is a multi-mission amateur radio ground station that is operated by students here at the Department of Aerospace Engineering. We have already operated 4 own space missions from here. Just recently, we operated a rover via a satellite from ESA. As a secondary ground station, we also support other non-commercial, most university or pure amateur radio satellite missions. We often work hand in hand with ESA operations, and in the near future, we will collaborate increasingly with the DLR. In this way, our students get the unique opportunity to gain first-hand experience by tracking and commanding real satellites. And today my team and I will make sure that the children who came to visit us can talk as long as possible with Matthias and can ask as many questions as possible. What it takes and how we do this, I'll show you now.
To be able to perform radio communications with the ISS, we first need a radio transmitter and an antenna. That sounds logical, right? The ISS is flying faster than a bullet from a shotgun. In fact, the ISS moves at about 7.5 kilometers per second. The frequency of the radio signal shifts according to the Doppler effect due to temporal compression and expansion of the radio wave as the distance between us and the ISS continuously changes. To compensate for the Doppler effect, we must constantly track the frequency of the emitted and the received radio signal from the ISS accordingly. Additionally, the distance between us and the ISS is rapidly varying between only several hundreds to several thousands of kilometers. Still, to be able to receive the radio signal well enough, we also have to track the motion of the ISS across our airspace. Actually, we do so by using a so-called directional antenna system, which is permanently following the motion of the ISS across the sky during the pass using 2 motors. Maybe you can now imagine a little bit better that it's not really that easy to talk straight to Matthias Maurer. But the good news is that you can ask him your questions without thinking too much about it. Because my students and I will do this tricky job for you.
This will all make sense when I am older. Someday I will see that this makes sense. One day when I'm old and wise, I'll think back and realize that these were all completely normal events.
And I can assure you that we will have as much as fun as you when you ask Matthias all your thrilling questions, from which also we are very excited to hear his answers and reactions. Meanwhile, as the ISS coasts toward us, we will configure the radio systems and rotate the directional antenna systems to the exact celestial direction the ISS will enter our ground station's sphere of influence. Because this task requires many manual steps, I need to verbally communicate a lot with my flight operators, my students, to get the steps done on time, similar to how you trained the mission operations voice protocol the other day. Well, when we apply the voice protocols for mission operations, it sounds a little bit like this.
Switch on ICOM 910H.
We'll go. And done.
Power on rotor control.
We'll go. Rotor control is active. Copy that.
To help our scholars to better remind the lessons learned from the voice operations training of Michael Schmidhuber from DLR GSOC, let him explain again why voice commanding is so essential in mission operations.
Yes, the voice protocol is fundamental. It depends a little bit on the mission phase, of course, and you can imagine that in the launch phase, all the people are very excited and in stress. That means you might be a little nervous, and then it's good if you have the words ready. On top of that, as you can see in the background, we're sitting in a big control room. In this room, many participants want to take in information simultaneously and play it back to get to the right place. For example, messages to the flight director or to the command operator. So nothing is going on in parallel or overlapping or misunderstanding. That's why we have to put rules in place. In human spaceflight, the rules are a little bit more strict, a little bit more specific. This is where NASA sets the language rules.
Okay, all flight controllers, go, no go for landing. Retro.
Go.
Fido.
Go.
Guidance.
Go.
Control.
Go.
Telcom.
Go.
GNC.
Go.
Econ.
Go.
Surgeon.
Go.
Capcom, we're go for landing.
Eagle Houston, you're go for landing. Over.
Everything is a little simpler and looser in satellite operations, but we follow the same rules.
But is it not so that English is the only language that's spoken even in German missions?
Yes, almost exclusively, so at least in the mission context, we always use English if it's not just about a test. You never know who's sitting on the other side. After all, we're talking to the test stations or the ground stations, and you don't necessarily know the people there on shift. Especially in the space environment, we have a lot of international colleagues, so there's always an international team involved in some way, even on German missions.
Thank you, Michael, for these excellent training units on voice protocol, which were inspiring for the children, my students, and also myself. The students in my team belong primarily to the people whose biggest dream is to work later in their career in such a mission control room. But who are those people exactly? And more interestingly, what are they made of? Let's start with Janis Terlau and let him introduce himself.
Hello, my name is Janis Terlau. I am 20 years old and study aerospace engineering at the Aachen University of Applied Sciences. Besides my studies, I am part of the FH Aachen Space Operations Facility's student operator team, where I am currently absolving my operator training for the upcoming ARIS call. I especially like the fact that you can combine the software technical part, which is more theoretically anchored, with the practical application as an operator and the whole in the FHASOF in an enjoyable, harmonious learning environment.
While the antenna rotor has to be operated by one person, it also needs the skills of another operator who exclusively takes care of the radio equipment. In this case, the operator is a woman, Anna Wehr. She is the one that takes care that every spoken word of the questioners is sent to Matthias, or uplinked, as we say in technical jargon, and that his responses are also transmitted safely to you in the lecture hall.
Hi, I am Anna. I am 22 years old and have been studying aerospace engineering at the FH Aachen since 2009. I am actually more of a Trekkie, so Team Star Trek, rather than Team Star Wars. It was a slight detour to aerospace engineering. It started when I was a kid, and I was really interested in physics. Then over the years, I became more and more interested in astrophysics, space, astronautics, rockets, which totally fascinated me and still does. Then I searched around a bit, tried different things, and ended up here at FH Aachen with aerospace engineering. I'm really happy with it so far. Since October, I am also a member of the Space Operations Facility at the University. I have come to it, especially now for the ARISS call. Back in school, I actually took part in a live call like that, and talked to Alexander Gerst on the International Space Station, and I thought to myself, hey, maybe I can bring in a little bit of insight. So far, I'm really enjoying my work. My daily routine looks like this. First of all, I follow my schedule from university, attending lectures and exercises, so far and around, always planning satellite overflights that we then take as training. And yes, it's actually a nice balance to come out of the lecture and then be able to directly apply what I've also learned really in practice. That's a lot of fun.
Immer wieder Satellitenüberflüge plane, die wir als Training dann nehmen. Und ja, es ist eigentlich ein schöner Ausgleich, aus der Vorlesung zu kommen und direkt das Gelernte dann anwenden zu können, auch wirklich in der Praxis. Das macht großen Spaß.
Okay, so that's it for the comm check. B1, let's step into configuration procedure 001.
Copy.
Since space travel is always costly, One attempts to ensure that the experiment or the mission can succeed as well as possible. One way to do this as its best is to provide vital systems in duplicate if the first or primary system fails and the mission would be compromised. In our case, the radio system is the one that is the most critical system. Therefore, we have designed it in duplicate. Thus, the so-called secondary system or backup system is just as important as the primary one. Consequently, it is armed just as the primary system. It is simply operated along to keep the downtime as short as possible. Fabian Glittenberg is the man behind the consoles of the backup system. He is the man to save our mission in case of an emergency.
Hi, I am Fubian. I am 21 years old, and I am studying aerospace engineering in the fifth semester here at the University of Applied Sciences Aachen. During a SpaceX rocket launch, I realized, wait a minute, you can study how to build rockets. How cool is that? And yes, since then I decided to do that, and now here I am. I started at the Space Operations Facility to gain practical experience and work with people from whom I can really learn a lot. I also like to spend time with them because they are interested in similar things as I am. I'm currently doing the operator training, and I'm learning how to use the big antenna up here on the roof to transmit to satellites, especially to the ISS. Besides, in the student project Star Trek, I also acquired and taught myself how databases work. I'm currently taking care of and working on it. I am really looking forward to getting to know the people of the FHASOF even more, and spending more time with them. It's really a chilly group.
We have always used real ISS passes over our ground station to simulate the operations as accurately as possible. We also employed people who acted as questioners and astronauts during the simulations. Of course, always and only in the presence of our amateur radio operator David Krieger, DL2DK, who, as you can hear, often had to strain his voice.
Delta Lima 0, Foxtrot Alpha, this is Delta Lima 2, Delta Kilo.
Delta Lima 0, Foxtrot Alpha, this is Delta Lima
2,
Delta Kilo.
Test transmission for Alpha Kilo, copy over.
November 2, Delta Lima Romeo, hier laut und clear,
Homie. Ich heiße Niklas und bin 12. Wird die ISS zu Geburtstagen oder Weihnachten dekoriert? Over.
My name is David. I am 28 years old. Originally I wanted to be a pilot. Then I decided that it wasn't fast and high enough. Combined with a general interest in technology, I decided to study aerospace engineering here. I signed up for a project here, at the FH Aachen Space Operations Facility, even before it had that name. They were looking for operators for their own CubeSat mission for the ground station here, so I did it. I just thought, controlling a satellite sounds pretty cool, so I signed up and got to know the ground station. First, as an operator, I later got involved in the ground station's technical systems. I then made the amateur radio license for the project and got into the ground station technology in general. In the meantime, I'm already doing the operator training myself and working on the ground station systems. In principle, I got exactly what I initially was looking for, something in which you can learn and start to understand entirely from the beginning to the end and then rebuild it. I can only recommend it to everyone to sign up here because, in general, space technology is always exciting. Especially working on student projects here because that's where you really learn it.
Raumfahrt im Allgemeinen immer spannend, auch vor allem hier irgendwas in welchen Studierendenprojekten allgemein zu arbeiten, da lernt man es eigentlich erst richtig.